What's up, guys? Just here to go in a little bit of a show, a little bit of an interim episode here, where we're actually gonna look through on all the soldiers, gonna go through how I outfit these soldiers, and like kind of the different pros and cons of the weapons, sorts of stuff like that. So we'll go ahead and start from the top. We'll go ahead and start doing some of the loadouts. Also, quick note from that last mission, we got Peter Van Dorn, as well as his buddy, Friendly, who's further down the list. We'll get to them in a little bit. Obviously, Van Dorn pretty much immediately. So, Lone Wolf being the gunner. All gunners are equipped here with the LMG. And really, for a gunner, there's only two choices you have. The LMG or the SAW. Yes, you can choose the carbine or the assault rifle or the SMG. However, what's the point? Every soldier can have pretty much any of those, although I'm not sure everyone can have the SMG, but everyone can have the assault rifle and the carbine, and most classes can have the SMG. So really, the benefit of the gunner is to go with either the LMG or the SAW. The default in Long War is the SAW. Now, the SAW is down on mobility. Pretty much both weapons are down on mobility. 6 ammo, and you can move and shoot with a medium range. You treat it a lot like a battle rifle or an assault rifle. Just it has a lot more ammo, does a little bit more damage. It's basically just a better assault rifle or a better battle rifle in that sense. I prefer the LMG. All of my gunners are equipped with the LMGs. The LMG is a -2 mobility penalty. However, it's a long-range weapon that grants squad sight for 5 tiles beyond normal visual range. So you don't need that much extra mobility. You can just kind of sit in the back like a sniper, but a little bit closer, so that you can just go ahead and lay waste to them. It does more damage than the SAW, which is crucial, especially as we get more into the armored units a little bit later on here. And again, its effective range is long range, so you want your gunners to really kind of stay in the back so they have that accuracy bonus, whereas you get them up close, they're not going to be able to hit anything up close. 8 ammo. It's the LMG, in my eyes, is better in pretty much every single way, but that does mean you have to keep your gunners a little bit further back. However, unlike the sniper, because squad sight is only 5 tiles beyond normal range with the LMG, it's actually safer to have the LMG over a sniper and a sniper rifle, and that's largely due to the seekers that will attach onto your units that are isolated. Your LMG is going to be fairly close to the rest of your squad, whereas your sniper, you might forget about him as he gets 10, 15, 20 tiles behind the rest of your team, taking pot shots from halfway across the map. You're going to forget about him, the Seeker's going to grab onto him, and you're not going to be able to get back there in time to save him. The LMG still has a squad sight, so he stays away from combat, away from danger, while at the same time still being able to shoot and deal a great deal of damage and stay close enough to your troops that you can easily save whoever has the LMG there. So, in my opinion, the LMG is the absolute best item you can take for the gunner, as far as guns are concerned, and all variants through that for the different types of weapons as well, laser gauss and plasma. The variations of that are, the LMG variations of that are what I want personally to go with. The other two things you'll see that are pretty standard, ceramic plating, which I have on everybody, really straightforward, it's +1 HP, but it's armor HP, not static HP. It's not the 6 HP that the gunner has, it's your armor HP. It's that additional +3. The ceramic plating just keeps your soldiers, well, one, it keeps them alive longer because they have more health, and two, it keeps them less likely to be wounded in combat because that extra bit of armor to take that extra bit of damage. Even if they are wounded in combat, it's going to be a little less major. So ceramic plating is a no-brainer for me. Always ceramic plating on everybody, simply because you have to keep your soldiers alive, or you're going to really be in a lot of pain very quickly. The second item varies soldier to soldier. Typically early in the game, I like to go for laser sights. Your soldiers don't have a lot of accuracy. So laser sights are pretty straightforward. It's just a flat plus four aim for the primary weapons and rocket launchers. So laser sight just makes a lot of sense early on because, again, you don't have a lot of aim with your soldiers early on. They're not leveled up enough. They have not ranked up enough to really merit grabbing that extra bit of... To grab something other than laser sight, I should say. They really need to have the laser sights so they can hit their targets. Now, you may not think four is a big deal, but it actually ends up being pretty significant, especially as you get in with aiming angles, flanking shots, and the sort. That four can make a difference. It can mean a difference between a kill and a miss, that 4%. So, personally, laser sight, really good. Scopes are just as good. Well, technically, scopes are better because they can also confer a critical chance later in the game. But it does cost money to buy a scope. So really, scopes are more for if you have a little bit of spare cash, pick up a scope. There's usually something better you can buy. I love scopes, absolutely. But when you play your cards right, you don't need the scope. It's a nice thing to have, but you don't need it. Kind of the same thing with the laser sight. You don't need the laser sight, but it is a nice thing to have, as long as you play your cards right. For everything else, alien trophies are interesting. They're really only useful. They confer the steadfast perk. It's really only useful on low will soldiers. 32 is pretty low, especially for a lance corporal. That being said, it's arguably the worst, because you're at that point you're assuming you're going to be hit, is why you're taking the alien trophy. You're assuming there's going to be panic of some sort, and to assume that's going to happen is just going to put you in a worse situation. That situation could be resolved by any of these four grenades, actually, honestly. HE grenade is your standard frag grenade from vanilla. Blows up cover, does damage, really good. Smoke grenade is just that, same thing from vanilla. It's a smoke grenade, it confers defense. And in some instances, buffs later on in the game. Flashbang is really cool. The flashbang grenade actually makes enemies suffer aim and movement penalties for one turn. Which is actually very, very helpful. We've seen the flashbang grenade earlier on in the series, and it probably saved our butts. Honestly, the flashbang grenade probably saved our butts. This is something we're going to be using later on. We're going to be looking at the abducting some aliens. I want to say alien abductions, but that's not true. We're looking at abducting some aliens, and flashbangs are going to come into much more prevalence at that point because I want to stun them. I want to keep them alive. So a flashbang is perfect for that. There's also something a little bit later on, the chem grenade, which is something we're gonna be mixing with the flashbang. We're gonna have the chem grenade go, which will get the aliens down to one HP, and then the flashbang will keep firing. We'll just keep throwing flashbangs at them while their HP is decreasing, and while we're trying to stun them, which will effectively stop them from being able to hurt us while we're standing right at point blank range trying to stun them. It's easier said than done. The theory behind it is essentially you're making the aliens completely worthless and you're forcing them to sit there and hunker down or sit there and overwatch while your soldiers are standing right there because they have one HP, so they want to run because they have one HP. However, the chem grenade, as long as they're under the effects of the acid, which is effectively just the thin man's acid, they don't want to do anything. So they just keep hunkering down because they're afraid they'll die, which they will. If they take an action, they will die. The aliens typically do not kill themselves. So using the acid grenades on them, the chem grenades, is one of the better ways to capture an alien. But the flashbangs right here are fairly solid, especially early on when chem grenades can be a little bit harder to come by. We're going to be seeing a mixture of flashbangs and chems later when we go into abducting aliens. So, last one on the grenades is the AP grenade, the anti-personnel grenade. Now, this is different from the HE grenade. The HE grenade is fairly low damage, but it destroys cover really well. It just obliterates cover. The AP grenade, however, does no damage to cover. It cannot hit through cover. You have to position the AP grenade in such a way that it will actually shoot out, spread out, and hit your enemies. They have to get it behind their cover, basically. You have to get the AP behind their cover. And that's tough in some instances. It means you have to be really close to the enemies. Especially with the effective range of medium, it really kind of needs to be positioned properly. Your soldiers do, in order to be able to launch that grenade into the right location to shoot them. I'm typically not a fan of the AP grenade. Grenades in general do a lot of damage to, like, weapon fragments. And it does damage to the corpses. Sometimes it makes many things you would have been able to recover from the aliens completely unrecoverable. That's true for the HE grenade as well, if you kill with these grenades. Mind you, it is if you kill with the AP grenade, or you kill with the HE grenade, not if you hit. The AP grenade can do up to 7 damage, which is a great deal of damage early on. You hit a big priority target. You hit a muton, a 10 HP buffed up, real strong muton, right? He's behind cover. You hit him with a full strength AP grenade. He'll still have 3 HP left. You've softened him up in one blow, more than what you could probably do with anyone else. The AP grenade is very, very helpful. Same with the HE grenade for absolutely critical, opening up enemies so you can blow them away with your absolutely critical shots. HE grenade is great for that. So both grenades certainly have their places on the battlefield. They're certainly useful. However, I don't like taking the risk of losing materials on the battlefield, whatever materials it may be. I don't want to take that risk, so I tend to avoid the HE and the AHP grenades. Later on in Long War, when aliens start getting tougher and tougher, and you need to land that critical hit, the HE grenade will become more prevalent, as it will open up the aliens in many instances to easy critical hits from snipers or gunners like this one here. They can deal the real damage. We've got the high cap mags, which are pretty good. However, it's really just one more shot. I mean, it's really not that special. There are instances, absolutely, as you guys have seen in my own videos, when I've been out of ammo in a really bad position. Like, I need that extra shot right now. Where the laser sight has failed me, and I'm not hitting my targets, but I need that extra shot, and all I can do is sit there and reload and hope for the best. High cap mags helps prevent that, gives you that one extra chance, but again, it's just one more shot. I don't know if they fixed the lock and load perk. I'm not sure if they've actually fixed that yet. I did not see anything about it in the change log, but that doesn't mean they didn't do it. That being said, all I really see high cap mag for is for one additional shot, and that's, in my opinion, not special. Medikits, we all know medikits. They are primarily for medics. They heal. Early on, when you only have rookies, you want about a quarter to a third of your squad to be armed with medikits, because they're going to have one. They're not going to be very good with it. And they're going to need it. Absolutely. As we start transitioning out of that super early rookie phase, we're getting into Lance Corporals and Specialists. We're going to be seeing more specialized builds. Where the medikit's not going to be on everybody. The medikit's going to be almost exclusively on medics. Of which we've made sure we have plenty. So, we will be seeing the medikit's. But, again, that's pretty much the same stuff as from Vanilla. For the rest of the stuff, Rocket and Shredder Rocket, it's really, that's for your Rocketeers, clearly. And ultimately, it comes down to playstyle. With your Rocketeers, you can choose a variety of different things. I like picking up an extra rocket, in this case, a Shredder rocket, most of the time. As it just, that's what Rocketeers do. They have the rocket launcher, they fire away. So it makes complete sense to arm Rocketeers with extra rockets, in my eyes. Whether or not it's the smart choice all the time, it can be debated, of course. But I like the opportunities to have additional rockets, especially when it comes down to fighting, like Cyber Discs, for example. You're going to want those extra rockets because they do deal a great deal of damage. Especially the Shredders, which actually just open up, potentially, the entire alien team for a couple turns under Shredders. So, really, that's just kind of how your strategy works out, whether or not you choose to take an additional rocket. Personally, I often take an additional Shredder rocket, but sometimes a fire rocket is all you need. Battle scanners are the same stuff you get from vanilla, and I am torn on battle scanners. On one hand, they're exceptionally useful. Having vision and knowledge of the battlefield is just completely, unimaginably useful. It's immensely valuable. But on the other hand, you could take a laser sight or a scope instead. You could take an HE or an AP grenade instead. I mean, it's something that really, there's always something better to choose than a battle scanner. The battle scanner itself is valuable, but there's always something better to choose. And drum mags are interesting. It's +2 ammo to the assault rifle, carbine, and battle rifle series of weapons at a -4 penalty to soldier aim. So this is very interesting, having drum mags. So what you could do here, and it's a good combo here, you could equip drum mags and laser sight to a soldier. Now the soldier would have an additional 2 ammo, say they have a battle rifle, so a battle rifle with 2 ammo, additional ammo, puts it to 5 ammo with no aim penalty. Pretty useful. But that's really only if you're going to be, like if you're certain you're going to be needing to do that. Personally, I don't see the need in going up to 5 ammo. Again, I think there's better ways to do it. Just straight up laser sight, giving that extra accuracy chance. You know, who needs to shoot more when you're more accurate? Honestly, being accurate is such a huge thing that you could easily end up being better off because you're more accurate instead of because you're firing more bullets than the enemies. There is a good combo to be had with the drum mags, but I strongly believe that the laser sight is superior simply because if you hit the target, that's going to be better than if you keep firing at the target and accomplishing nothing. That being said, if you build a suppression specialist, an Overwatch specialist, someone that will either use suppression pretty much every turn to keep at least one of the aliens locked down, or they will be using covering fire often to shoot at the aliens when they're potentially vulnerable, you build like that, they are going to be ammo hogs. They're going to be the people that need the drum mags. And in that case, the -4 penalty doesn't really matter because the entire purpose of that soldier is to suppress and control. The entire purpose really is to control the battlefield, those kind of soldiers. That's where the drum mags really come into use there. You know, it's, when you look at drum mags versus high cap mags, I would say drum mags is the superior choice. Yes, you get the -4 penalty, but you're never going to really need high cap mags. It's one more shot, whoop-dee-doo. Drum mags, you will need for your suppression specialists. You'll need for your covering fire specialists. High cap mags wouldn't be good enough for them. The drum mags really would be, because your suppression takes 2 shots, takes 2 ammo. That's one free suppression right there with drum mags. So, very, very useful, but again, very, very specific situations. universally speaking, laser sight, ceramic plating. I just can't see myself going without ceramic plating on any soldier, personally. It's just far, far too good. The last thing to cover here, at least for gunners, anyways, gunners and rocketeers, always tac armor. Tac vest is not worth it. It's completely pointless. It gives you plus 3 mobility, plus 1 HP. Tac armor is plus 1 mobility, plus 2 HP. That extra HP is just so vital that who cares about the extra mobility, honestly? Who cares? I have seen soldiers time and time again get damaged exactly as much health as they have remaining, and they were wearing a tac vest, or they weren't wearing ceramic plating. Really, when it comes down to it, you want to keep your soldiers alive. A living soldier is a usable soldier, not a dead soldier is completely worthless to you. So use your tac armor, use your ceramic plating. When it comes down to your weapon choice and your second item slot, again, that does come largely to whatever your personal choices are. But I say, as far as the standard soldier goes, you're going to want the laser sight. You're going to want an AP or an HE grenade early game. Although the laser sight would be superior in that instance. And then maybe a medikit if you don't have a lot of medics. If you're really strapped for medics, maybe take a medikit instead of the laser sight. But in this playthrough, we have tons of medics, so we're fine. I think we have like 5 or 6. We're plenty fine on medics. Just take one medic per mission. So really what it comes down to for the standard soldier, early on, laser sight, easy. Maybe a smoke, maybe a flashbang, depending on whether or not it's a frontline soldier. Going into the mid-game, HE grenade, AP grenade. You want damage, you want to be able to open up the aliens. Those grenades will do it really well for you. Chem grenade later on as well for capturing. And then going into the late game, when we get there, we'll get there. But at that point, you're going to be wanting definitely flashbangs. Because the aliens are going to be really, really tough in the late game. You're going to want the flashbangs to really shut them down. Or at least slow them down. Put them on a fair footing. Going back to the weapon choice here. Now, you know, we're always going to be taking tac armor. We know we're always going to be taking ceramic plating. And pretty much always going to be taking laser sight. So for the rest of this, we're talking about primary weapon and secondary weapon choices for class types here. So gunners, like I mentioned earlier, LMG is superior to the SAW in my eyes, and there's no reason to go for the SMG assault rifle or assault carbine. It just is a waste of being a gunner. Moving on to the next one here, we have a medic, Yoda Skywalker. So medics are a tricky thing. Obviously, medikits, absolutely. Medics are a very, very tricky thing because you have to balance between firepower and mobility. You want your medic to be able to get anywhere at any time because you need to be able to heal your soldiers. You need to keep them alive, and you need to be able to, you know, really make sure that your team is okay. And the medics are what do that. The medics hold the team together in times of turmoil. So you really have to be careful when you choose your primary weapon. Battle rifles are amazing. They do massive damage, but it's -1 mobility. If you look at the standard assault rifle, there's no change to mobility. It's just straight up, it's a good gun. It just gets the job done. The assault rifle, which should just be called an automatic rifle, but whatever. The assault rifle is actually just really straightforward. The carbine is a very tempting choice when it comes down to your medics, because the carbine, it does less damage, yes, but it confers extra accuracy, so you're more likely to hit, and it confers that +1 mobility, which is very, very tempting. Unfortunately, with the carbine, I have been burned far, far too many times. You take the shot with the carbine, you hit the target, it looks great, and then the damage resistance kicks in, because the alien's hiding behind full cover, or they're hiding behind, they're hiding behind high cover, or they are just naturally high on damage resistance. Their armor is high. So this base damage of 1, if you do just 1 damage or 2 damage, you're not going to do anything to the alien. It's completely wasted shot. So while the mobility is very tempting here with the carbine, the damage difference here, 1 to 5 compared to the 2 to 6 with the assault rifle, the damage loss on the carbine just makes it not really feasible, in my eyes, to choose the carbine. I have done 0 damage too many times with the carbine to make it worthwhile to choose for that extra mobility. I just don't see it being necessary. And then my quick opinion on shotguns. Universally, I hate them. Absolutely hate shotguns. Yes, they do a lot of damage. They have a high crit chance. And that's great. Unfortunately, with the shotgun, it just means you have to get right up in the alien's face. And that's not how I play. That is not at all how I play. With the shotguns, you have to be ready to run up straight up to the alien's face, shoot them in the face, and hope that you kill them. You hope that you kill them. Because if you don't kill that alien, you are in a world of trouble. Completely and horribly, just in an unspeakable trouble. Because that alien will then turn next turn and probably one-shot you with their plasma weapons. They'll probably just blow you out of the water. They have superior weaponry. Getting up close to them, face-to-face, I don't see being at all a smart choice. You're just gonna, you're asking yourself to be killed at that point. You're asking to take damage. Now, if you get the kill, and the shotgun's good at it, does a lot of damage, it's likely to get the kill. If you get the kill, it's real quick and easy. It's more likely to get that kill right off the bat. It does more damage. It has a much bigger range as well over the assault rifle, or even over the battle rifle for that matter. But I don't think it's worth it risking a soldier's life to use a shotgun. Now, if you come prepared with a flashbang grenade, that someone is ready to pop that flashbang if the shotgun misses or it doesn't kill, you can potentially salvage the situation. But you have to be prepared. You have to be ready to take that risk in the first place, and that's not a risk I am willing to take. So you won't be seeing shotguns as a primary weapon on any of my class types, because I do not want to risk losing a soldier. I much prefer to keep my soldiers alive. And the best way to do that is to not get shot. So, for the medic, ultimately, I choose the assault rifle. The SMG is also another interesting choice. Like the carbine, it does 1 to 5 damage at a medium range. Only has 2 shots, so you really gotta pick and choose when you're gonna shoot. But the big thing for the SMG, which makes it very tempting, is that +3 mobility right here. You really get a lot of mobility out of using the SMG. Unfortunately, again, that 1 base damage, it's too low. I just don't see it being useful. The solution to medics being too far away in that instance, then, when you're on the battlefield, if you're worried about your medics being too far away or they can't get to your guys, make sure that your medics kind of stay more in the center of your formations. As long as your medic is in the center, they can run from side to side, forward or backwards, and take care of the team. If you put him out on a flank and one of your guys gets taken down on the other flank, even with the SMG, you may not be fast enough. So ultimately, you want to keep your medic in the center of your formation, center back preferably, and keep them equipped with an assault rifle. Battle rifle is not really worth it. Medic's going to be moving around a lot. Battle rifle loses accuracy on movement. And then the carbine and the SMG just do too little damage. So the assault rifle is the go-to weapon there. Next up, we have a scout. So scouts, I actually like to equip one with a sawed-off shotgun. Now, remember, I was just went on a rant of I hate the shotgun, so why would I choose a sawed-off shotgun? Well, that's because I'm mixing that with the marksman's rifle. Now, but for a scout, the scout's going to be... Well, it's going to be having the lightning reflexes pretty much every time. It has lightning reflexes. So you're going to be running around, and you're going to be moving a lot to draw out the overwatches. With that, you don't want the battle rifle. Battle rifle loses accuracy when you move, so you don't want that. SMG is tempting, carbine is tempting because of the extra movement points, but as we talked about, they don't do enough damage. And the shotgun, again, I'm not a not in favor of the shotgun. So at that point, it comes down to two weapons. Do you want the assault rifle, or do you want the marksman's rifle? I choose the marksman's rifle for my scouts. We go and look at it real quick. 12% base crit chance, 2-8 base damage. Now, it may not make a lot of sense to use a long-range weapon for someone who has lightning reflexes. However, on the battlefield, it's actually far more applicable than you would think. Most of the time, you and the aliens are going to be fairly close together, and you can move your scout forward or backwards, left or to the sides as needed, when you're close enough to the aliens, and they will draw out the overwatches every single time, while still keeping your dude, your scout, in the back, relatively protected, far away, so the overwatch is less likely to hit in the first place, but still close enough because you'll be able to still fire back at the aliens. Now, with the marksman's rifle, it does not confer squad sight, which guarantees you will be close enough. If you can shoot the aliens, they can shoot you. Which means lightning reflexes is still perfectly usable while still using a long-range weapon. Because it is a long-range weapon, notice the, also ammo 5 there, we'll get to that. Because it is a long-range weapon, in the event, say, a thin man falls from the sky and jumps on top of your formation, you're gonna need a short-range weapon to make up for that. So the sawed-off is a perfect complement to the marksman's rifle. The marksman's rifle is going to be absolutely terrible at close range. At medium range, marksman's rifle is still going to do okay. At short range, you need something else. The pistol, it does too little damage, whereas the sawed-off does a perfect amount of damage. It's small, it's portable. Unfortunately, it does confer one minus one mobility, but it is a perfect choice being a short-range weapon to complement a long-range primary weapon. So, the sawed-off, I think, is a great choice because, again, if that thin man jumps in the middle of your formation, you need something to handle them right away. Sawed-off will do an instant kill, and it'll do it with great accuracy because of that short-range bonus. So, really what it comes down to, when you look at the difference between the marksman's rifle and the battle rifle, like I mentioned earlier, the marksman's rifle has 5 base ammo, but it can also move and shoot. So it makes the marksman's rifle very, very helpful. So then you might ask, why would you ever use the battle rifle over the marksman's rifle? It's because the battle rifle... it's because the battle rifle is medium range. That's right. That was the reason. So when you're deciding what weapons you're going to choose for your team, you need to decide both where your soldiers are going to be placed on the battlefield and what is their functionality in the battle. So the battle rifle has less ammo, and right here, right as it says here in the blue text, taking any blue actions will reduce aim by 10 until the beginning of the next turn. So with your battle rifle, you need to be in a good position to fire and stay put and keep firing. Where is the best position to do that? Medium range, which is exactly where the bio rifle is used. This is what we'll see is primarily on infantry. Infantry are more frontline. They have two shots, so they need to be able to shoot several times. So then you think, well, why not the marksman's rifle if they're shooting several times? Because they're going to be up front. They need to be able to hit multiple aliens. If you're from long range, you may not necessarily be able to shoot every single alien that is on the battlefield. Whereas if you're in medium range, you will be far more likely to be able to both see and shoot at the aliens that are there. So the battle rifle is far superior for soldiers that are going to be up front and not necessarily short range, but they're going to be the soldiers that are your front line is what you use the battle rifle for, whereas the marksman's rifle is more of your back line. It's the people that are there to largely support your front line soldiers, and I see scouts as a solid support position where they will be moving a lot, using those lightning reflexes, using holo targeting to get those shots for the frontline infantry in a good position going forward. So they need that long range to stay in the back, and they need to be able to shoot and move in the same turn without losing any accuracy. So the marksman's rifle is the choice here for the scout. Moving on, we have the Rocketeer, and you can see already Peter Van Doorn, the Rocketeer. As I mentioned earlier with Rocketeers, and the rocket launcher, the secondary item slot, I like those shredder rockets and rocketeers. Sometimes I'll go fire rockets depending on what kind of mission I will be expecting. However, with an alien crash landing, with an alien ship of any kind, I will try not to bring rocketeers, or if I do, bring shredder rockets, not fire rockets, because you don't want to damage the alien ship. The alien ship is very valuable. So that's where the shredder rockets really kind of come in here, is keeping alien components alive without really doing any major damage. As for primary weapon choice for the Rocketeers, you have three choices. SMG, assault rifle, carbine. SMG really doesn't matter. You don't need mobility with a Rocketeer most of the time. The carbine is interesting because it does provide that extra bit of aim, plus 6 accuracy for the soldier. So it makes your rockets more accurate because your aim is at a plus 6. However, rockets are big explosives. They have a wide radius. Rarely do you need a precision rocket. Like, that's not something that really ever happens. So getting that plus 6 isn't really a big deal. You're just going to fire the rocket and it's going to go where it's going to go. 90% of the time, it's going to hit what you want to hit, or it's going to be beneficial to you in some way because you fired that rocket. So the fact that you might be a little bit more accurate with your rocket, sometimes it's better to be less accurate, actually. Because if you look back at the previous episode, I fired two rockets, the shredder and the fire rocket. I used them both. And you notice there was a little scatter number. I think the highest I got it was like 2.9 or something like that was the highest scatter I had. Now that scatter is 2.9 tiles in any direction, which means you can actually end up shooting the rocket further back than you would normally be allowed because of the scatter. So if you have a higher aim, you might hit exactly what you want, but it may not necessarily be exactly what you should hit because it might be something a little bit further back that you can't see that if the rocket scatters, it'll hit it and do some serious damage there. Now, the argument here might be, well, what if I need to make a precision shot because I'm firing a rocket and it's really close to an alien ship, or it's really close to a canister of meld? Simple solution to that, don't fire the rockets. Never fire a high explosive, whether it be an HE grenade or a rocket, near high priority targets. If you destroy that high priority target, you're going to be kicking yourself. So just don't fire the rocket in the first place, or if you must fire the rocket, give yourself enough tiles away that the scatter won't hit the target. That if it scatters off towards the target, it still won't reach the target. Give yourself enough space. If you must fire that rocket, give yourself enough space. Even with the additional plus six aim, you're still not guaranteed to hit your target. So try to not shoot at high priority targets and enjoy the scatter, because sometimes it is more beneficial than what it appears to be at the first shot. That being said, the carbine fails in a second place in that its damage fails. So assault rifle is a choice for the Rocketeer. It only has three choices, and the assault rifle is the easy choice here. Infantry. So if you guys watched my previous Long War Beta 14 playthrough, you know that infantry was my take home. They were my bread and butter, my favorite class, absolutely, because they just decimated the aliens. Infantry is a phenomenal, phenomenal choice. And with an infantry, I position them up front. They're the people that are going to need to see a lot of aliens because they have a lot of shots. So I give them the battle rifle. They're going to be up front. They're going to need to do a lot of damage, and they're not going to be moving. You put them in a good position, and you just open fire every turn. You're just fire and fire and fire in a good defensive position. You know, typically high cover would be your best choice there. They're not going to be moving around a lot. They're not drawing out shots, and they shouldn't have to reposition, assuming your initial position that you took is good, or that you're properly taking out the aliens that might be trying to flank you, whether it be with the infantry or with your support further back with the marksman's rifle. However, there is a second way you can play the infantry, and it is a way that I've been thinking about and experimenting with, and that is using the they can't use the marksman's rifle. Never mind. I was experimenting with them being further back with the battle rifle instead of the marksman's rifle, but it's just not worth it, ultimately. Like I said, you want your infantry to be up front so they can see a lot of aliens. The point is to see the aliens and be your front line, and that's how I treat my infantry. They are my front line soldiers, and they need to be able to shoot a lot, and the battle rifle is, of course, the perfect one for that. They're not moving, so they're not losing their accuracy bonus, and they are doing massive damage. I mean, the battle rifle does 2 to 8 damage with an 8 to 13 crit, whereas the assault rifle is 2 to 6 and 6 to 10 on a crit. It's just better overall as long as you don't move. If you move, then it's a problem. Do again take note that this is 2 to 8 with a 12% crit on the marksman's rifle. It is a high crit weapon. But that being said, same damage as a battle rifle. And the battle rifle is really what I choose to be for infantry. Sidearms really kind of comes down to what kind of position you think you're going to be in most of the time. Sawed off is tempting because you might end up getting shot at from a very close range, or an alien might move up to be right there, especially chrysalids. So the sawed-off is very, very tempting. However, I don't see it being wholly necessary. The pistol can take care of business most of the time for your close range enemies. Unfortunately, it's not that damaging. It's 1 to 3. But the pistol is there for in a pinch. The machine pistol is strictly better than the pistol, 1 to 5. It's the same damage as the carbine. at a -1 mobility and a -8 accuracy when drawn, which is why I don't go for the machine pistol. Mostly because of the mobility for the machine pistol. I just don't see it being really helpful. It's not really worth it for someone who's going to be up front. You want that soldier to get up front and stay up front and push that front line. So losing that mobility could be pretty big for that frontline infantry. So that's the primary reason why I don't take the machine pistol, is I don't want to lose that mobility. Now, losing the mobility is not the end of the world. You have yellow moves, and most maps are very good at giving you enough cover to move from cover to cover with blue moves exclusively. But occasionally you come across one where you need a little bit more distance, and in those situations, a machine pistol would be very detrimental. At the end of the day, the infantry is going to be using mostly its battle rifle. If you have to switch to your sidearm, something has gone pretty horribly wrong. So the sidearm doesn't matter so much. And for that reason, I largely stick to the pistol. I kind of wish I could remove the sidearm, just say no sidearm, and get one mobility back. Actually, I would probably do that for the infantry, is just remove the sidearm entirely. But because I have to have a sidearm, I'm going with pistol. I think it is the right choice. It does the right amount of damage. And it has the right amount of ammo. So, moving forward, sniper. With the sniper, you will now see I carry the machine pistol. So, sniper's gonna have really one of two things. Marksman's rifle or the sniper rifle. As you saw, the marksman rifle, go ahead and relook at those stats. Really solid weapon. 2 to 8, 12% crit chance, and soldiers with squad sight, i.e. snipers, can target enemies and conduct reaction fire at 5 tiles beyond visual range. That puts it on par with the LMG. The sniper rifle is 2 to 8, 8 to 13, with a 20% crit chance. It is a -1 mobility, but do take note, just like snipers back in vanilla, they cannot shoot and move in the same turn. It's just not allowed. But with a sniper, you shouldn't need to shoot and move. You should just be sitting back and taking pot shots. Your crit chance is very big, and that's going to give you great opportunities to do a lot of damage from far away. The biggest thing when you're playing with a sniper is don't forget about your sniper. You want to play the sniper as if they're carrying the marksman's rifle, but they're actually carrying the sniper rifle. Keep them close to your squad. Keep them with your gunner. That's a really good baseline. Keep your snipers with your gunners, but don't give them the marksman's rifle. They should not need to move and shoot. However, that being said, if you are a snapshot player, forego snapshot entirely, grab the marksman's rifle. Marksman's rifle basically gives you snapshot as a sniper, just without the ability to shoot from all the way across the map. But it is much safer if you keep your sniper with your squad anyways. And the extra crit chance from the sniper rifle is just superior. So stick with the sniper rifle. The crit chance is worth it. For the sidearm, you have two choices, the machine pistol or the regular pistol. Now, with your snipers, if they have the sniper rifle, they cannot move and shoot. So losing the mobility with the machine pistol, not a big deal. And this goes back to what we were saying earlier when we were looking at these sawed-off shotguns. If a thin man jumps on top of your position and you have a long-range weapon, you're in trouble. So the machine pistol here is all the sniper can really carry, not a sawed-off. I would probably go with the sawed-off instead of the machine pistol for the sniper if I had the choice, but it's not a choice. So the machine pistol is as good as it gets. That extra 2 damage for the loss of mobility, honestly, 3 damage, even if you crit, 5 damage. It's just not worth it. It's just such low damage. The machine pistol is the clear choice, up to 8 damage, potentially, if you get a flanking shot. That it's just the better choice. So the machine pistol, you're not going to be needing to move your sniper, and if you get up close and personal, the machine pistol just does more damage. So, sniper rifle and machine pistol for your snipers. Assault is really kind of back and forth for me as far as the weapon choices are. But ultimately, it's along the same path that we said earlier with the medics. You have to balance mobility with accuracy and damage. Those are your three factors. And just like the medic, you don't want the battle rifle because your assault's going to be moving. They have run and gun. You don't want the carbine or the SMG because they don't do enough damage. And I hate shotguns because they put you at too much of a risk. They put you too close to the enemy. So the assault rifle is the remaining weapon choice. The sidearm, you see, I'm going with the sawed-off shotgun. Now, you cannot forget the assaults have run and gun. You can't forget about that. It is very, very valuable. So, with that, there are instances where the shotgun is superior, where the shotgun can be used, where it is safe to use the shotgun. And so, for those instances, I have the sawed-off shotgun to mix with run and gun, because you want to make sure you have that option. With the assault, it's really about keeping your options open. So the sawed-off just gives you that additional option where if you need to, or if the time is right, run and gun up to the alien's face and pull the trigger, and you'll be fine. Most of the time, you'll see me using run and gun with the assault rifle just to get into a better position or a flanking position. But sometimes, you will see me use a run and gun with a sawed-off shotgun. And that's largely because I wanted that additional option, and it pays off. Most of the time, there's no reason not to use the assault rifle. But sometimes you need that sawed-off. Now, for the engineer class, again, this is along the same lines as the assault class and the medic class. You have to balance damage, mobility, and accuracy between the three. Your engineer is going to need to get fairly close to your aliens, but they're not going to be in suicide range. Shotgun is suicide range. You don't need to be that close. The assault rifle puts you close enough to the aliens without making you lose any weight, or without making you lose any mobility that the battle rifle would do, or lose any damage that the SMG and the carbine would do. So again, the assault rifle is the proper choice here for the engineers. It's enough damage while allowing you to still move enough. It's a reoccurring theme. The assault rifle is just a really good standard weapon. Because they do need mobility, however, a pistol is pretty much required. A sawed-off, you'd think, maybe a sawed-off, because they'll be fairly close to the aliens. They're one of your frontline troops. And they're only using an assault rifle instead of a battle rifle with one shot. They only get one shot per turn. So you'd think, well, maybe a sawed-off would be superior here, where they're going to be getting close to the aliens anyways. Maybe you'd want to use a sawed-off. But the Grenadier, in this instance, the Grenadier really needs to have more mobility than I would argue the Assault does, because the Assault can run and gun. The Assault does not need as much mobility, because they have that run and gun potential. Whereas the Medic and the Engineer need to have their options open. So, in that case, the sawed-off shotgun and the machine pistol give too little mobility. They take away that one mobility from you, whereas a standard pistol does not. So that's when you really want to make sure that you have that extra mobility. Thus, I go with the pistol here with the engineers. For the item for the engineers, however, they are a grenadier. Engineers are grenadiers. They have extra grenades. They do extra damage with grenades. Battle scanners are not grenades, so don't go for the battle scanners. Personally, I like to go with the HE grenades. Like I mentioned earlier on when I was talking about grenades, The AP grenade kills more often than it maims. So you don't want to use an explosive to kill an alien. Flashbangs are really good support grenades. Good choice. Smoke grenades, again, good support grenades. But a flashbang is often better than a smoke. And then the HE grenades. Now I'm playing with absolutely critical. So the HE grenade is rather vital, as it can open up the aliens from behind their cover and just tear into them. The HE grenade can really just open them up and let the absolutely critical shots take it from there. So removing the cover with the HE grenade is the choice that I would make for the Grenadier perk here, is to have the ability to destroy cover, the ability to damage or destroy vehicles as well, as what the HE grenades really brings to the table. And I believe that is actually all of the classes. We got Sniper, Scout, Rocketeer, Gunner, Medic, Engineer, Assault, and Infantry. That is all of the classes here. I will go through and I will outfit every single soldier with the proper loadout according to their class. And then as we tech up, you will see that we will actually get potentially different loadouts and different weapons as we go through and get Gauss weapons, laser weapons, and plasma weapons. That the loadouts will change a little bit based on the weapons we have available, simply because the technology is a little bit better. But until then, the basic loadouts I described here is going to be the basic loadouts that I recommend for any Long War playthrough. Especially now we're on Beta 15. These are the loadouts that I would say are the absolute best loadouts going by my tactics on the battlefield. And I endorse it through the fact that, as you guys have seen, now I'm on a 9-mission unbeaten run in this playthrough, and what was it, 39 mission unbeaten run, something like that, in the previous playthrough. I had never lost a single Long War mission, and through that I feel that the choices here are solid choices that will benefit anyone in their playthrough. Now if you object to any of these choices, let me know in the comments. Let's have a discussion down below. I'd love to have a constructive debate about what are the best builds for each individual class type and what are the best builds for each individual formation. You guys have seen my formation before, where I try and make sure I have a flanker on each side, a solid core, and then kind of a line going backwards, where we have frontline, two frontline infantry with your mid-range, kind of your marksman rifle in the center behind them, and then the sniper in the very, very back with two flankers, typically assaults or potentially scouts or rocketeers running around the sides to get a good flanking shot. You guys have seen that strategy work right there in every mission. It's always being acted on. And for my strategy, these builds work very, very well. However, they may not work for every single strategy. So I recommend, if you're having a hard time, leaving me a comment down below. What is it that you're trying to do? Sometimes pictures are the best way to do that. If you take a screenshot on Steam with F12, I can see what it is you're trying to do, and then also let me know about what your builds are, and I'll be happy to discuss with you on what is the best way to progress further on in Long War. Obviously, Long War is a very difficult mod. It is a very stressful mod, at least for me, probably for everyone who plays it. And it's also a great mod, and it allows for a lot of tactical builds. It allows for a lot of tactical maneuvering and choices. Whereas, like I said before, you wouldn't think that going with a marksman's rifle, going with a marksman's rifle with a scout would be the right choice, because a scout should be a fairly frontline infantry with lightning reflexes. But when you remember that the marksman's rifle doesn't actually give you that squad sight, all it does is put you right there up front, then within sight of the aliens, then you know you're going to be in the right position to use lightning reflexes, which makes the marksman's rifle the right choice. They don't have to be in front. In fact, it's often better if your scout can be a little bit further back. They bait out the overwatch every single turn, but they don't actually get shot at when it's the alien's turn to shoot. So if you get hit by one of those overwatch shots, which has a chance to hit, and the first overwatch has a 10% chance to hit, the second overwatch has a 30% chance to hit, there is a chance you could get shot. If you do get shot, you know your scout is not going to be shot at next turn because he's not the frontline soldier because of this marksman's rifle capability. So this marksman's rifle actually makes a lot of sense when you keep your scout further back to exclusively bait out the overwatch shots. So little things like that, when you look at the actual tactical maneuvering, does tend to make a little more sense, but it is a little counterintuitive. So again, like I said before, if you have comments, if you want to start a discussion, please put a comment down below, like the video, share it with your friends so they can jump in on the discussion as well. Beating Long War is a collective effort, so I do ask that everyone puts in their two cents. There is no stupid answer, and there are no stupid questions, so at the very least, I will not laugh at you, and if anyone does, I will defend you if you ask a question or you throw in your two cents. As long as you're respectful, you will have my full support. So please put a comment down below. Let me know what you think about how I'm organizing my soldiers, as well as how you organize your soldiers. I love to get some back and forth here. So that's going to be it for this little episode on soldier builds and how to approach Long War Beta 15. So as always, guys, thank you for watching, and I will see you next time as we actually move on here to the UFO crash site here in China and continue this Long War Beta 15 playthrough. DFTBA.